Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Let me welcome you to tonight's discussion. I'm Otto Thoresen. The short version is almost 40 years in the industry, a qualified actuary, which I keep quite quiet, which we could discuss later if you're interested, but currently chairman of NEST, National Employment Savings Trust. And also, the reason I'm here is I'm chairman of the Pensions and Long-Term Care Steering Group, which has oversight over the product research group, which we're going to hear from tonight. Before we get on to the subject matter itself, some housekeeping, there always is. Anybody who wants to claim CPD for this meeting is responsible for entering the CPD on their own online record. By collecting your name badge, your attendance will have been listed on our systems for auditing purposes. If you don't have a name badge, you'll need to sign the registration form. The meeting's being filmed and recorded for publication in the British Actuarial Journal, so please, when we come to the Q&A, clearly state your name before making your contribution. And please wait for a microphone to be brought to you before you begin your contribution and make sure you speak into the microphone. Could we all switch off or put to silent our mobile phones and keep it that way through all the sessions? And if the fire alarm sounds, please leave by the nearest fire exit. Now, I haven't been told where they are, but I suspect they're at the back there somewhere. Normally, I get my opportunity to do my EasyJet steward interview at this point, but not today. We have quite a lot of speakers, so I'm going to skip pretty quickly through them. I'll start with the group we have here up on the table with me. We have Tom Kenny sitting here on my left. Now, Tom's the chair of the Products Research Group. Tom's been involved in product design and pricing of retirement products, if I can describe them that way, Tom, for many years now, and before he moved into his current role as head of retail pricing at Partnership Assurance, where he's been since 2011. Expertise clearly there from his career, and he'll be talking at the end of the meeting, summarizing the discussion and closing on behalf of the research group. On the far left, who's not here yet, the empty seat belongs to Paul Burstow. Paul will be joining us, I'm confidently informed, any minute now. He'll proceed up the centre of the room triumphantly, probably at a very inconvenient moment for the speakers, but I trust they'll be able to cope with that. Paul, of course, served 2.5 years as Minister of State for Care Services in the Department of Health during the coalition government, where he had an extensive brief, including care for the elderly, adult social care, mental health, cancer, diabetes, and learning disability programs. And he was, of course, importantly responsible for setting up the Dilnot Commission, which we may hear a little more about shortly. Since leaving Parliament at the 2015 general election, Paul has chaired 2 year-long independent commissions, one on mental health with the think tank Centre Forum, another on the future of residential care with the think tank Demos. Richard Purcell, who is here, is head of technical marketing at Vitality Life, and his role there is focused on helping to research, develop, and market new protection products, bring new protection products to the market. He's also an active volunteer in the IFOA, having previously been on the Health and Care Research Committee. Currently, Richard's on the Health and Care Conference Committee and is also editor at the Actuary magazine. And we'll be hearing from Paul and from Richard after we hear from the product research group themselves. Moving on to them, we have, sitting in the front row here, Ben Rickason, who started his actuarial career in pension consultancy at Bacon and Woodrow, where he qualified in 1990. After around 10 years at Bacon and Woodrow, he decided to move into academia and took up a lectureship at the City University London, where he's worked ever since. He's been head of the Faculty of Actuarial Science and Insurance at CAS Business School since 2008 and was promoted to Professor of Actuarial Science in 2013. His main research interest is health long-term care in particular. We've also got Jerry Barnfield. Jerry has held a number of roles in the industry, most recently Group Head of Market and Product Strategy at Aquila Haywood. He's now retired and working as a volunteer advisor for the Pension Advisory Service. Then moving on to Linda, if I can just find, there we go, Linda Daly. Sorry, Linda, just a momentary hesitation there. She's an actuarial science lecturer in the University College Cork. Linda's worked as a pension consultant with Mercer for over 10 years and subsequently joined the university in 2012. Linda conducts the main part of her research in the area of mortality and morbidity studies, as well as the funding of long-term care. Now, in a moment, I'll ask Ben to stand up and begin to introduce the paper and take us through it. But before I do, this question of how we deal with the funding for care in later life has been with us, it seems, for decades. For me, it's been a subject I've been close to for much of the last 10 years. I think we all hoped that the Dilnot report in July 2011 signaled the opportunity and potential for real progress. In 2014, in January, Norman Lamb, Minister of State for Care and Support, signed a statement of intent with me as Director General of the ABI at the time, and we declared that the industry and government would work together to create the right conditions for a larger market in financial products in this area. Then in March 2014, we had the Freedom and Choice budget, then followed in 2015 by the deferral of aspects of the CARE Act, which had been built off the Dilnot report to 2020 at the earliest. So I think we approach this with the need clearly still there and growing, with the environment in which product and advice solutions need to work still developing and evolving. I think a great opportunity for the actuarial profession to shape the way that policy develops in this area, and I think the work of the group is extremely valuable. I'd like to hand over now to Ben to kick off your opening remarks.
Thank you, Otto. Good evening, everybody. I'd like to start by thanking the IFOA for giving our working party the chance to present this work. I'm going to begin by giving you some background to the work that we've been doing. Then I'm going to discuss briefly insurance and other financial products which we consider in the paper. And then I'm going to hand over to Linda Daly, who's going to take you through the case studies that we've produced in the paper. And finally, Jerry Barnfield will describe the results we've obtained from the modelling of care costs. One comment I would make clear is that we were writing the paper on the basis that the CARE Act 2014 would be implemented in full. In the event the government decided to delay implementing phase two of the Act until 2020, and in particular, they announced last year that the introduction of the care cap of £72,000 and the new means test limits would be deferred for those 4 years. So we've taken the opportunity to consider in our paper what the social care landscape would have looked like if those changes had been made. In other words, we hope the paper is going to act as a catalyst for policymakers to consider what changes should be made to social care by 2020. Now, I've been carrying out research in the area of long-term care since the mid-1990s, and I remember very clearly the discussions that took place on this topic in this hall when the Royal Commission was set up in 1996. There were many opinions about what should be done, but about one thing everybody could agree, the social care system couldn't possibly stay as it was. So it's fascinating and slightly disappointing to see 20 years later, we seem to be in exactly the same position as we were 20 years ago. This perhaps isn't surprising when you actually consider the position of the main players in the social care arena, the individuals, the state, and the private sector, including insurers. The individual is reluctant to even contemplate making provision for long-term care, since it's such a grim and unsavory subject. There's also a lack of awareness around the topic, made worse by the complexity, and our case studies that Linda's going to talk about should make that clear. And people hope that they'll never need long-term care, so they feel they'll be wasting their premiums. And with something like a one in four chance of actually not requiring, of only a one in four chance for requiring care, they may well be right. The state, on the other hand, is reluctant to make big, irreversible decisions on social care, since the costs always come out looking so high. Hence the phase two deferment to 2020. And the insurance industry is not surprisingly reticent about devoting lots of time and money in developing products because they might not sell, since there's no certainty that a future government won't reverse the decisions made by a previous government. So we live in this state of what I'd call unstable equilibrium. I'm sorry to paint such a gloomy picture, but it shouldn't stop us trying to develop products that might help people fund their long-term care, since that cost won't go away just because we don't like thinking about it. I'd now like to turn to the work described in the paper being presented tonight. Our working party was set up about 3 years ago, and we presented a paper here in 2014 which analysed the way in which pension-type products could be adjusted to help long-term care. We were then asked to consider by the profession more widely after that what kind of financial products, i.e. not just pensions or insurance products, could do the job, hence the paper before you tonight. As we consider the array of products analysed in the paper, we need to bear two things in mind. First of all, it's not a matter of one size fits all. Different products will suit different people, depending on their personal circumstances, such as wealth, home ownership status, and whether they have dependents, and so on. And secondly, we're in a new paradigm with regards to the pensions freedom and choice agenda, which came into effect last year. It's still too early to say how that will play out for individuals in practice. So which products we considered in the paper? I start with the products we included in our previous paper in 2014 and update the situation in the light of the changes that have occurred since that paper was published. We know that pre-funded long-term care products have not sold in the past. Had the cap of £72,000 been introduced, then we felt there might be a market for cover up to reaching that cap. However, with the cap being delayed to 2020, and many people wondering if the cap really will be introduced, given that 2020 is the year of the next election, the scope for pre-funded long-term care products seems very limited at the moment. By contrast, income drawdown does seem to lend itself well to the concept of funding long-term care, particularly as a result of the freedom and choice pension changes mentioned before. In our previous paper, we suggested that some thought be given to introducing a pension care fund. This would be a ring-fenced long-term care fund set up within a defined contribution pension fund with attaching inheritance tax advantages as well as the usual tax advantages being offered. However, with the new flexibility around pensions being introduced, the tax advantages of the pension care fund seem to have largely disappeared. Disability-linked annuities are products which we think have a lot going for them. We believe that individuals would find it attractive to receive a standard annuity while they are healthy, but be reassured that the annuity will increase to a much higher level to help defray the costs of care should they require long-term care. This seems to be an unusual long-term care product in that it has a positive spin to it. And the fact that long-term care would not expect to begin for many years for that individual into the future and wouldn't expect to last very long when it does begin should make the extra premium payable relatively low. We also think that an alternative to that disability-linked annuity is one which pays nothing while the individual is healthy, but again, a high level of annuity once the person requires long-term care, and that's worthy of consideration. A relatively small cost would be associated with that. Immediate needs annuities and variable annuities are well established, and I won't say anything more about those at the moment. So then we've explored the idea of introducing innovative non-pension products. A few companies have started to introduce accelerated whole life products, where an accelerated payment is made should the policyholder require care in either a residential or domiciliary setting. The eventual death benefit would be reduced accordingly. This product is aimed at people who wish to take out a whole life policy but are worried about the unexpected costs of long-term care should it be required. Since the sum assured will definitely eventually be paid, whether it's triggered by death or by long-term care, it's a low-risk way for an insurer to enter the long-term care insurance market. And I know that Richard's going to be saying some more about that later. With such a high proportion of older people in the UK owning their home, we believe that equity release has a big part to play in the funding of long-term care. However, the ongoing review by the PRA presents a risk to the market that equity release products might become expensive and therefore less attractive. Apart from those existing equity release products, it's worth considering the UK Equity Bank product, which my colleagues at Cass Business School, Professor Les Mayhew and David Smith, have advocated and written a paper about. Essentially, the state acts as the lender. We also described in our paper the concept of the care ISA. This would be an ISA where the fund was ring-fenced to only cover long-term care costs, with the facility for it to be passed from one generation to another. There were rumours that it would be introduced in the recent budget, since a strong advocate was the pension minister, Baroness Altman. In the event, a lifetime individual savings account was introduced instead, which is aimed at helping people under age 40 to build up their savings, but not specifically with long-term care in mind. A final product that we mentioned is aimed at people who have only a basic pension and modest savings. This is the personal care savings bond, and is an idea developed, again, by Professor Mayhew and David Smith. It's like a premium bond with monthly prize draws, but would earn a small amount of interest and pay out once long-term care was required. This product seems to tap neatly into the lottery mentality that we all seem to possess. So let me now hand over to Linda Daly, who's going to discuss the case studies we've produced. These illustrate beautifully how complicated the current social care payment structure is. But just before I do so, I wanted to end on a thought-provoking note. A recent survey commissioned by the IFOA disclosed that about half the respondents had considered long-term care costs, but only 4% of the respondents had made any kind of provision. Clearly, there is much work to be done in convincing people to think about their future long-term care needs. I'll pass on to Linda.
Thank you very much, Ben, for that handover. My name is Linda Daly, and as part of the working group analysis, we decided to kind of develop a number of case studies to illustrate the complexity of the system, and in particular look at how the proposed cap of £72,000 and the new means thresholding limit would work in practice from 2020, when all aspects of the Care Act are in place. I suppose if you're any in doubt regarding the complexity of the system, hopefully these case studies would help illustrate the point. I suppose in our report, we looked at three people in detail with different financial backgrounds, and I'm briefly going to lead you through two of the three examples contained in the report. So the first example we're going to look at is somebody called Susan, and she's married, and she enters a care home costing nearly £33,000. Of which £12,000 of the daily living cost to cover the basic essentials like heat and food. She has an income of £21,000, which includes a state pension, a private pension, and she's also in receipt of the NHS funding allowance included in that sum. So she qualifies for the NHS funded allowance, but we've assumed she doesn't qualify for the attendance allowance. Her home is jointly owned, and it's valued at £200,000, and the couple have combined savings of £50,000. The reason we picked this example really was we wanted to illustrate the case where the home is excluded from the financial assessment of what somebody is required to pay, given her husband is still living in the home. And also, given that they have combined savings, it's just 50% of the savings are taken into account in the financial assessment of what Susan is required to pay. So this graph is going to lead us through how the funding of her care costs form before the cap and after the cap. So you can see here on the first column, we have the local authority set rate, which is the first component of the cost of the care home. And on top of that, there's those daily living costs. So that brings us up, as I said, to the figure of £33,000, which is the cost of Susan's care home. We've assumed that she's going to enter the care home. So in the first year, she's going to use her estate pension, her NHS funded allowance, and her 50% of her private pension to fund the cost of care. She's entitled there, we can see the state pension less the personal expense allowance. She's entitled to keep £25.77 a week for herself. But other than that, she uses the rest of her income to fund the cost of care in the first year. Also, she has her portion of her savings, which are 50% of the total savings between herself and her husband, which is £25,000. She has to contribute a portion of her savings, and we call that tariff income. And there is a fixed formula for that, which says for every £250 you have over £17,000 in savings, you need to contribute £1 a week. So that actually works out at over £1,600 in the first year. So that's the first makeup of the care costs. As you can see, there is still a funding gap. So the local authority will kick in because under the means threshold, she's paid what she can and fund the balance. And a similar picture arises in the second year. Obviously, she's going to be paying a little bit less in the tariff income because her savings are gradually diminishing as she's paying out a portion from them. But it's a very similar picture in the second year. And that keeps going forward until approximately 3.5 years, where £72,000 has been contributed towards care. What I mean by that is not including the daily living costs, but the local authority rate has been built up. The metered costs have come up to £72,000. After that, the cap kicks in. So again, she still needs to pay for her daily living costs going forward, but the local authority will kick in and fund the balance. And that's kind of how the picture will look going forward. So as long as she kind of meets her daily living costs, the local authority will fund the balance once she has reached the cap of 3.5 years. I think the key thing from this example is it shows how when the home isn't taken into account under the means testing limits, because her husband is currently living in the home, so it's excluded from the financial assessment of what she's required to pay. The next example we look at is a relatively well-off individual. Her name is Mary, and she's single, and she's going for a more expensive home than the previous example. Her care home is nearly £43,000, which again is made up of the local authority rate of 33, which includes the £12,000 daily living costs, and she's also elected for, because it's a more expensive home, it's another £10,335 on additional top-up costs. So she's going for a more select nursing home, possibly. She again has an income of £21,000, and it's made up of her state pension and private pension. She's also in receipt of the NHS funded allowance, we've assumed, and the attendance allowance. Now, she owns her home mortgage free and valued at £200,000, and she has £30,000 in savings. So this person is single. So one thing, because she doesn't have a spouse living in the home, her home can be taken into account in the financial assessment of what she's required to pay. So we're going to look at two scenarios for Mary. First of all, we're going to assume that she doesn't use her home effectively as collateral under the deferred payment scheme. And the second example, we assume that she enters into the deferred payment scheme. So again, we look at a similar graph as we did for the previous example, and we have the care costs on the first column. And you can see that the local authority rate is the first component, then there's the daily living costs of 12,000, and then there's this excess over the local authority rate, which we determine called the top-up costs. So the funding in the first year, we assume that she pays as much as she can Okay, so she uses her state pension, the attendance allowance, the NHS funded allowance, and the private pension, and then she, because she's a relatively well-off individual, she has to use her savings to fund that balance. That's in the first year. In the next year, it's a similar picture, but her savings are going to be depleted by year two because she had £30,000, and in year two, she has her savings have run out. Then we assume that either a family member or some other third party steps in and takes the burden of that balance, the shortfall here, which we call the top-up payment. And that picture is going to continue, again, until about 3.5 years, at which point Mary or the third party will have contributed £72,000 based on the local authority rate only. It's the £72,000 cap doesn't include the daily living costs or the top-up costs. It's just based on what the local authority would pay towards nursing care. So we'll assume that £72,000, it actually turns out that it's reached in about 3.5 years. After that, Mary is still, and the third party is still responsible for paying the daily living costs and the top-up costs, but the local authority kicks in because she has reached the cap. And that kind of stays in a steady state from that point on. So that's an example, assuming she has the luxury of a third party to cover her bill, or maybe she doesn't want to burden somebody. So an alternative option for Mary is that she basically takes a loan out against her house, which we call the deferred payment scheme. So looking at this again, we assume that the three costs of the nursing home are there, so bringing it up to 43,000. And the funding in the first year, again, she pays as much as she can. So she pays all her pension, her private pension, and her savings. And again, her savings run out in year two, at which point there is a shortfall. So because she's living on her own, her house can be taken into account in what she's required to pay. So she basically enters this deferred payment scheme where she takes a loan out against her house, and that loan will be repaid once Mary is deceased and her estate is sold. So that's the component of the loan that she takes out in the second year. In the third year, she really has no savings left at all, so she has to take out a bigger loan. Okay, so the gap is a little bit bigger. And again, by about 3.5 years, she has contributed the £72,000 towards the cap from the local authority set rate. So the funding in year four, you can see here that the state pension, she pays as much as she can, and then the local authority kick in because the cap is reached after 3.5 years. And in 4 years, the cap is implemented in full. So she actually just doesn't have to borrow that much against her house at all. So the red block starts getting smaller again from that point on because the cap has kicked in, so she doesn't need as much as a loan against her house. So I suppose like every loan, it grows with interest if it's not paid back. So this graph shows how the deferred payment scheme progresses over the first 5 years once it's taken out. So the differences are quite big in the first year. She doesn't need any loan in year one because her savings have been used, but in year two and year three, there's quite a big jump. And you can see then in year four and year five, that gap starts getting smaller because she has to borrow less given that the cap has kicked in. I suppose we chose this example because we wanted to show how the care cap and the means testing limits would work when somebody's house is taken into account. And there's a third example in the report as well, which you may be of interest to you, for somebody living in rented accommodation. And these two examples are covered in more detail as well. So you may be interested because there's a lot of technical details here. So hopefully it has illustrated how complex the new system is. So I'm going to pass you over now to Jerry, who's going to lead you through the incentive to save and probability section. Thanks, Jerry.
Okay, thank you, Linda, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jerry Barnfield, and within the working group, I've worked on some of the modelling that we've developed over the last year or so. These include modelling the cost of care, the likelihood of needing care, the probability of reaching the care cap, the regional variation of some of the results, and the incentive to save for potential care costs in future. Some of the modelling work is an update to the work we did in 2014 with more up-to-date data, whilst the incentive to save modelling is completely new. So we'll start with a couple of slides that recap the detailed modelling that we did in 2014. So some of you might have seen a previous version of these slides, but they've just been brought up to date. This slide shows whether individuals entering care homes at various ages are likely to benefit from the 72,000 care cap that is proposed to be implemented in 2020. The results indicate that, given the assumptions set out in the paper, females entering care homes at the average age of 85 have a 14% probability of reaching the cap, compared with 8% for males. The vast majority will not reach the cap because they will not survive long enough to do so. Linda went through some of the key components of funding care costs. It's important to recognise that some of the components vary by region, especially the care home costs and the local authority set rates. This results in significant variances in the probability of reaching the cap and the length of time before reaching the cap, as you can see from the slide. Individuals in care homes in London and the South are likely to have a higher probability of reaching the cap and in a shorter period than those in other regions. This brings up questions as to whether there should be a regional care costs as currently, or whether there should be a standard rate across the country, like the daily living costs and the attendance allowance and NH-funded allowances. So one of the major challenges that we have to address is the incentive to save for potential care costs in future. Whilst we recognise that state provision of social care needs are subject to a means test, it does mean that for many individuals, there's no financial incentive to save for potential care costs. Some individuals will save for long-term care needs so that they can influence the type of care or the quality of care they receive, or indeed the location of a particular care home. For financial incentives, our model demonstrates that the current means testing approach is a significant disincentive to save. The changes in the means test proposed for 2020 would reduce this disincentive, but there would still be a significant disincentive to save. We believe that further changes in the means test should be considered before 2020 to reduce the disincentive to save. So this chart looks at the impact of the current means tests on saving. In the model, we look at what happens if an individual decides to increase their level of saving by an additional £10,000 over and above the savings they expect to have at the point of entering care. So for example, say an individual expects to have £40,000 in assets at the point of entering care. What would be the impact of their personal contributions to the care costs if they save an extra £10,000 before entering care? So the total care costs payable by the individual over a 10-year period would increase by a bit more than £12,000 as a result of the £10,000 increase in saving. This means that saving the extra £10,000 has resulted in the extra saving all being taken away as a result of the reduced means-tested benefits. This is a bit of an extreme example, as only 1% of those in care are likely to be in care for a 10-year period, but the point remains. Okay, so this next chart shows an equivalent analysis for the CARE Act 2014 means-test limits, which are scheduled to be implemented in 2020. It shows that there's a greater incentive to save under the new system. In this case, a person expected to have £40,000 at the point of entering care, who saves an additional £10,000, their total care costs payable over a 10-year period increases by £8,000. So the individual actually has £2,000 left over to spend. Whilst this offers a greater incentive to save than the current means test limits, the individual is still losing 80% of what they have saved as a result of the means test. Overall, we think there could and should be more done to increase the incentive to save for potential future care costs. So, in terms of the session that we've gone through so far today, we had some conclusions. I would like to go through some of those conclusions before we move on. Firstly, we believe that a year after the introduction of freedom and choice, it is still too early to understand exactly how individuals will respond to the new freedoms. Secondly, the care funding system is very difficult for people to understand. Whilst the proposed changes in the Care Act in 2020 would be beneficial for consumers, it will make it even more complicated. And lastly, the current means testing system can cause a disincentive to save with an effective tax rate of over 100% for some people. The proposed changes to the means testing system in 2020 will reduce this disincentive, but it will still exist, whereas we really need individuals to be incentivized to save for their potential care costs in future. Our recommendations to address these issues are set out in the paper, and I think Tom's going to refer to these when we come to Tom's bit. So overall, I'd just like to thank all the members of the working group and the IFOA team who have supported us over the last year. Thank you very much.
And those who have been paying attention will now have spotted that our panel is complete. Paul, thank you for joining us. You missed my excellent introduction covering all your achievements, and I'm not going to do that all over again. I would ask you now if you would to give your comments, and I'd encourage both you and Richard to be concise and to the point if possible, because we do have, I'm sure, a lot of people in the audience who also want to engage in discussion with us.
Okay, well, first, thank you very much for the invitation, and my apologies for missing your excellent exposition of my career to date. Normally, I try to be on time, but I apologise for that tonight. So, first, just some reflections on the paper and what I've heard, but also perhaps a slightly broader context for the policy that is embodied in the Care Act, the Dilnot cap and changes to the means testing. I think the first thing to say about your paper, you set out the history of many, many fruitless attempts to try and address some of the perceived unfairnesses within the current arrangements for paying for long-term care. And I think all of those have one difference to the reforms that this paper talks about, the 2014 legislation, and that is that they are in legislation. For the first time ever, we have a new legislative framework that provides a basis on which the level of the cap can be determined, the level of the thresholds for means testing can be determined. And that's a significant shift and a significant opportunity going forward. I think there are two reasons the government chose to postpone, and I'm going to use the word postpone in quotes, the decision to go ahead with implementation this year. One I've heard bandied around frequently, but I think unfairly, was the continuing absence of new significant products coming onto the market. My counter to that personally is to argue, how would you expect a market to respond when there has been so much uncertainty historically, and the government's decision to postpone has created yet more uncertainty, so why would the sector deliver a new product? And then the second, which was to some extent conspired with by others in the sector, was a question about the overall funding of social care in this country, and a suggestion, which I don't think actually can be demonstrated to have been fulfilled, that if the introduction was postponed, some additional money would come into the adult social care system as a whole. As I say, there isn't much evidence to suggest that the Treasury has repurposed the monies that were earmarked towards the end of this Parliament for that particular purpose, and certainly there are significant pressures in the system. I think the recommendations that are set out in this paper are all very sensible. I think the need for an awareness campaign, should the recommendations in the legislation be implemented, is absolutely necessary. I think that the proposals around data collection make perfect sense to actually have a better understanding between industry and government. And I think the discussion just now about new incentives also makes a lot of sense and is heartening in terms of the analysis with respect to the current system, how the new system would work. But I think probably the thing I wanted to add to this debate was that one of the reasons for introducing the cap was not just to protect assets, not just to protect people from the risk of catastrophic cost. It was also to effect a change in terms of behavior with respect to people engaging with their local authorities and planning in a more long-term way for care costs and for the meeting of their care needs. In other words, placing a whole part of our population who are self-funding much more clearly on the radar of local authorities. And by placing them on the radar of local authorities, engaging one of the duties that sits within the Care Act, which is to prevent and postpone the need for care. In other words, it would create the opportunity for public health interventions for a sensible conversation to take place at an early stage with people about how they manage their care journey, but also how they perhaps minimize the need and the risk of going into more expensive, heavy-end care. So I think that's the biggest opportunity that is missed by not bringing in the legislation. And that's a benefit that would have been gained very early, whereas the cap itself would have really had its benefit much later in the life of the legislation. So I think that, for me, is one of the significant losses. I think the final thing I would say is come back to my point about the government arguing that part of the reason for postponing was to help with the stabilisation of the social care system as a whole in terms of funding. We've had one parliament where there has been a significant reduction in spend by many local authorities on their adult social care commitments, and it's now forecast that by the end of the current parliament, we will have halved the proportion of GDP that we spend on long-term care in this country from a paltry 2% to around 1% of GDP. That will have profound implications, not just for the viability of the publicly funded marketplace, it will have significant implications for the overall viability of the marketplace for care services in this country. And there are many providers who already speak to those points. And it also is accelerating the bifurcation in this market. Those that are funding and being provided for in completely separate service provision models compared to those that are state funded. So I think for a whole series of reasons, your paper is a very helpful contribution. When the announcement was made last year that there was to be a postponement, it almost caused no ripples at all. It did not cost the government politically, it seemed, much whatsoever. Now, that may be partly because of the complications of explaining what this is about, but I also think that there is still an opportunity during this parliament to make it a political issue, both in terms of the funding of the whole system, which I think has to be front and centre, but also the equity and fairness questions that the Dilnot Commission was tasked to try and address and did provide, I believe, an elegant solution to. So that would be my quick response to the paper and to the wider issues.
Thank you very much, Paul. Richard.
Thank you. So my perspective is as one of the insurers that has brought to market a new solution, which is referred to in the paper as an accelerated whole of life policy for long-term care. So essentially allowing people to use their protection policy and access that cover early should they need it in later life. So so my observations come from that perspective. Firstly, I'd like to thank the product group for their work, and I do support their recommendations. For me, though, I think the point of complexity is perhaps the most significant one, and that's why I think the call for more education is going to be very important. And I think this is where we have a massive challenge as a country. And I think, you know, a national awareness campaign will be valuable. I think also there's a very important role for advice. So I thought I'd just share with you a few observations that we've had in launching a new proposition through advisors, some of the challenges that we've had, and some of the research that we did with consumers and advisors. Some of this is not kind of particularly surprising, but we ask customers kind of what are their concerns when they're thinking about kind of planning for care later on in life. And unsurprisingly, you know, remaining in control is top of the list. So whether it be, you know, being able to make decisions, looking after yourself, or remaining independent. And being in control is king, effectively. So that's important, I suppose, in thinking about our product design. You know, what do we bring to market? What are customers ultimately trying to do when they're thinking about the future? The other point is around customer mindset. And we found quite a wide range of mindsets, I suppose, amongst customers. One on the left-hand side kind of represents really people's own experience. So people, say, in their 50s or 60s, who had seen their own older parents go into care, they had that first-hand experience. And that was very, you know, emotive, but they could see that need more clearly. Which is, again, not surprising. But at the other end of the spectrum, there was a group of people who I suppose were kind of almost trying to ignore the future need. So that they view themselves as being, you know, kind of young at heart, carefree, and didn't really care much for planning for the future. So trying to address that group of people, I suppose, is going to be particularly difficult as a whole industry. And the need for advice was also quite interesting. So how do people expect to pay for care? And again, some expected results, expecting that the state would pay, came up top, but also using personal savings and investments. Interestingly, 23% thought they would not be able to pay for care at all. So we need, I think there's a bit of education there about, you know, actually, well, the state might pay, but as we've seen from those case studies, you know, there's a lot of complexity around when or how much it will pay. And also, there is a need. Our kind of assessment of what people are likely to need suggests that 40% will be in some form of financial difficulty in later life. So there is definitely some need there. And just looking then at the advisors, I mean, so we're a protection provider selling most of our products through the advice channel in the UK. And that's what we're, I suppose, what we see as a challenge in creating and bringing to market a new solution. So I've tried to estimate how many advisors I think are qualified to advise on full long-term care. So that's sort of defined as the CF8 qualification. I think it's about 2.5%. This is not a scientific estimate, but this is what I think is the case. So actually it means that whilst we have a big set of advisors out there, not many of them are qualified to talk about the full set of existing care products in the UK. Now, I suppose we've created a product, a protection product, which doesn't fall under that kind of traditional care banner, and therefore advisors don't need to be qualified. But actually they lack the confidence to talk about the whole subject. And so a couple of quotes on the right-hand side show you, I suppose, the level of uncomfortability amongst advisors. They lack that understanding. They think there are, you know, there's a grayness around rules, and also something that there just aren't the appropriate products out there. I mean, I personally would disagree that. I think there's a lot of products out there, but it's just about helping the advisors understand what is there and what they can be doing for their clients. And I mean, I've gone through the process of trying to work out how can we help advisors better understand that journey. And I've started from scratch, you know, not actually being an expert on care myself. And you go through that journey of understanding what the state provides and what products are out there. And actually you realize quite quickly there is a lot of complexity in how do advisors get their head around this. So I think there's a big job there to help advisors as well as customers think about their needs and how they think about it. So I suppose I kind of conclude here really that there's a lot of solutions here to help, I think, kind of close that advice gap. Increasing the demand for advice. We've mentioned a public awareness campaign. I think that would be valuable. I think being more innovative about the way we pay for advice, and there's been some great ideas suggested recently. The proposals around a pension advice allowance, allowing people to draw down from their pension to pay for advice, also advice vouchers. And I think it would be great to see that remit covered to more broadly cover care and pensions. Hopefully that will be the case. And also thinking about how we can improve the supply of advice in the country. There's much talk about guidance at the moment with, you know, changes to pensions wise and MAS, and also about robo-advice. And I think that's welcome. We need to think about different forms of advice for different parts of society. But I think we already have about 22,000 advisors in the country. So actually we've got a massive sort of footprint of advisors that we should be working with and leveraging to improve education. So that's why I'd support, I think, industry working more closely with the advisor community to help them you know, get out there and talk about care needs with their clients. So that's my observation, really. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, well, without further ado, we can now open the meeting to the floor. And I'd ask anyone who wants to make a contribution to indicate appropriately to me. But I would remind you the meeting is being recorded for publication in the British Actuarial Journal. So please state your name before making your contribution. Wait for the microphone to be brought to you and speak into the microphone. So any contributions from the floor? Don't be shy. We have one up here on the right, well, my right, your left.
Jules Constantino. I'm a member of council of the Institute and Faculty of Actuaries. Thanks to the authors for a great paper. I mean, I think your first paper set the grounding for this paper, and actually you've carried it forward very well. I have two questions that aren't really addressed, and equally I'll ask the question of Paul Burstow as well. You make no mention of compulsion as a means of stimulating the market. I would contend that there are sufficient overseas examples that demonstrate that that might be an interesting way of kickstarting a market. And then I'll ask a question which is on the opposite side, which is to say, we haven't really had long-term care products for a long time now, and yet people have gotten by. Why should that change going forward?
Paul, do you want to go first, then maybe Tom, you can pick up from the group's point of view.
The question of compulsion, it was not something we asked Dilnot to look at. We did debate it in framing the terms of reference for his work, and we did draw some analogies with the pension arrangements that have now come in and the payroll giving that takes place that way. And indeed, there was some, at least internal contemplation as to whether there was an opportunity to build something into that system. And maybe that would have been a better, tidier, more complete way of addressing it. And I think partly reflects, if I'm honest, the fact that the development of pension policy and the development of social care policy and the funding of social care have tended to be developed largely in silos, even within government. And although there has been some cross discussion, not sufficient, and certainly not a sufficient desire in the last government to make that a centrepiece reform. So I think that's unfinished business, and certainly something to come back to. And I just say your second question again, sir. Just remind me.
It was just, let's say, saying people have done without insurance-style products.
Yes, so the absence of any solution has not hurt anyone. Is perhaps the sort of some sort of rather crude summary of that. I would contest that. I think it has both hurt in terms of the very obvious goal, which was around protection against catastrophic costs, but I think it's hurt in a more subtle way. The sort of psychological shock that people sustain when they learn that this is a system that is not free. We just heard in the presentation just now that 36% of people still think it's going to be paid for by the state, conflate it with the National Health Service, if you like. So I think that's still sitting out there as a real reservoir of anger, of frustration. I think it's underscored by the sense that people save and are not rewarded for that saving by this system. Indeed, they're penalised very, very hard. And I think the issue now is one that to not sort this issue out makes sorting out the bigger question of how we sustain a social care system that has a formal element to it also gets pushed off the agenda. If I'm honest, politically, one of the benefits of having implemented a cap, if it had come in from this year, is that we would have brought into the system a whole group of people who would have been alert to the fact that we had an inadequately funded poorly operating system in this country, and it would have created a much greater lobby for both investment but also reform of the whole system. So as well as the public health gains I was talking about earlier on, I think that's been lost. And I think there's a very simple reason for that. You only find out that there's an issue when it's too late to do anything about it. It's people in this room and other gatherings that are concerned about this who have a role to play in creating the noise in the system, whether it's informed policy framework, detailed work of the sort that you are doing, but we need that noise, we need that agitation. There has to be a political cost for not doing anything. And the message the Chancellor gave last year was there is no political cost.
Tom.
On the compulsion one, I guess it's not something that we touched on kind of incentives, and we did a lot of analysis to try and pick that as a particularly around the means testing, but tax policy, and we haven't really gone into that. I think it is definitely an area that the profession should look at, and I think there is an area of research around sustainable funding models. And perhaps that's a good area to actually pick up, should we introduce compulsion. The other point around no products for a while, I think the whole issue with social care funding is that it's becoming more and more important, and our profession is one of the best positioned professions in the country to see the demographic issue that's in front of us. So the population that's affected by social care policy is going to grow dramatically over the next 20 years. And I think we, in our public interest role as a profession, we should be informing the debate around it and making people aware, making government care about it. There should be a political cost to not having it high on the agenda. And I think that's a big role that we should play.
Thank you. We have a contribution here near the front.
Thank you. My name is John Spain. I'm a DB Pensions Actuary. And I think it's an excellent paper. I'm very grateful to the authors for presenting it. But I'd like to ask about figures, numbers, which is what you'd expect from an actuary. This paper is really about demand, whether it's met by the consumer or indirectly by the consumer through insurance of some sort or other. But what about the supply? I'm looking at example one, 32,000, I think it was, or a year. That doesn't buy you very much in the southeast, and that was recognised on another chart. And I think it was called Southern Home Care a few years ago, which went bust. I think we also need to look at the supply of care, because the extent to which some care homes are absolutely awful. If dogs were treated like that, there would be a problem politically. But people, doesn't really matter. So I think you need to take that into account just a little bit more, please.
Okay, thanks for that. Certainly outside the remit of the product group, but Tom, I'm sure you've got a point of view, but I'll give you a moment to think about it. But Paul, this is probably right in your bailiwick. So.
When you said you wanted to ask a question about the numbers, I immediately thought, good, that's not for me then. but your point about supply, I think, is, in a sense, really underscores the point I've been making. This is a market in which, this is the provision market I'm talking about here, in which still the vast majority of it, and in some regions, almost all of it, is dependent on the state funding that comes into the system. So if you're in the southeast, yes, the premium to come into the system is higher and you're paying it yourself, but there is a bigger and more viable private market. If you're living in the northeast, the private market is very small. The numbers of people paying into it is very small relative to the southeast. And its viability without a viable state sector is much, much diminished. So this is a question that affects more than just those that are the direct beneficiaries. And as the example showed, there are people who have a mixture of different funding. Many more people are contributing indirectly through top-up payments to their provision, as well as the state contributing. So I think this question of supply absolutely is at the heart of any debate about how we privately pay for our care and the contribution that the state through the taxes we pay puts in as well. And what we've seen, I think particularly in the last decade, is a decoupling of public funding for care being related to demography. And by the end of this parliament, that will be writ large, and it will have implications for many families who will no longer have an easily available care option available to them, and informal family care will be the backstop and will be shouldering a much greater share of the burden than it already does.
Richard, have you got anything you'd like to add to that?
I agree. I think the supply of care is important. I guess I'd broaden out the supply of advice and more broadly is an important issue. So the whole supply side is important, I think. Yeah. I agree.
Tom, anything more from you? Okay, thanks for that. I think we'll obviously have the opportunity to do another paper on that subject. But any more questions or contributions from the audience? We have another one down here.
John Instance. I was very much, I also enjoyed the paper, but very much taken by the complexity argument. And what worries me too with the focus is on all these different products, that also creates complexity. And, you know, I just wonder, yes, clearly we as a profession have a public interest in getting out there and explaining the need and how the things work. But I would have thought actually, what do people need? They've got a house, so we have equity release, okay, and we can improve that maybe, but that's the product, or otherwise they're just going to need cash. We've got freedom and choice under pensions. You've got either a pension pot or you've got an ISA. Now, I know George Osborne loves different types of ISAs and care ISAs and lifetime ISAs, but actually, you know, basically, there is a quite an efficient tax-free savings product out there already. And so do we actually ought to be spending less time on product, saying, well, actually, it's not really product. It's about making things simpler for people to grasp. I've always thought complexity, the industry has always been very good at complexity. We've got all these little tweaks and bells, and it's a way of adding cost and charges and things like that. But we need to come off that and make life a lot simpler. And then that would make it easier for people to understand and actually to grasp the issues. Actually, I have to save some money. And things like that. I'd be interested in how we as a profession can lead that reduction in complexity argument.
Yeah, thanks for that. I think the one of the things we can do is to help people begin to come to grips with how the system actually works or how it's proposed to work. I mean, I've heard the presentation on the case studies now probably two or three times in different forms. I'm finally starting to get a grip on it, I think. But then not every man and woman in the street's going to be willing to give it that time. But for me, the challenge is how do you and when should you engage with people in trying to get their attention on this subject so they can begin to come to grips with what's involved. And yes, in the end, it is adequacy, which is a large part of the discussion, the adequacy of the savings that have been made. But from the panel's point of view, maybe Tom, I'll give you this one, because it's a pretty direct provocation on the whole thing you've been working on for the last 3 years. So how do you respond on this issue of you're chasing the wrong rabbit here?
Well, I think I totally agree. Like simplification is always something that you aim for, particularly when you're trying to develop products. But as Ben highlighted, when we looked into this, that there isn't really one product that fits all. It really depends where the person is in their kind of saving life, really. Are they pre-retirement? Are they at retirement? Are they in retirement? Are they at the point of need? Just going into care. So I don't think you can possibly reduce it down to three or four products to, for the different stages of life. But I don't think you can get away from having more than one product. And it also depends. Certain people are willing to take on different risks, aren't they? So as an individual, if you understand it, are you willing to take on longevity risk? If you are, then you might not buy an annuity. But if you are aware of that risk, then you might actually decide to buy an annuity, particularly if you're about to go into care and you understand the possible variation in life expectancy at that point in time. You might think, actually, it's quite a good thing to buy an immediate need annuity because it actually provides financial certainty for your loved ones, or actually it's usually the loved ones that are actually making the decisions at that point through power of attorneys. So I think I get the point around it's very complex and we're potentially making it even more, proposing that it should be more complex by offering a wider range of products, but I don't think you can really get away from that.
Maybe, Paul, if I could ask you to develop on a bit. I mean, it strikes me that the challenge we still face is that people haven't really got a sense of what the state does provide and what their personal responsibility, either them or others who can help them, actually is. And I've been involved in this stuff for quite a while. Governments are not always very good at being absolutely clear about how a system can work and what personal responsibility the individual has to take. Do you think that's part of the problem, or do you think that might change?
I mean, I think it's also, that links to the point, I think, that your first presenter, Ben, was saying about the idea that this would be introduced in 2020, an election year. I mean, the decision to implement it in 2016 was very much for that reason, because although an implementation of the Dilnot system would have been a significant advance on where we were, it would have still raised a whole set of questions, because it wasn't the actual amount you were paying, it was the amount that the council notionally had set as what it would pay. Once you start getting into that, you do start to get into a whole set of rows, because you then have a new postcode lottery of different local authorities' determinations, some of which can be justified, some of which cannot. So the desire to delay it was partly driven by those complexities and a fear of how you would explain some of those things. I think you still have to explain those things, and that's why I support the recommendation of awareness raising. I think that access to good information, the local authority signposting, one of the things that some of us argued during the passage of the legislation was that the handoff ought to be more than just a handoff from the local authority to other agencies. There ought to be much more of an informed discussion there to make sure that people did actually avail themselves of more advice to facilitate their planning. So I think some of the points that have been made there were very important. I said at the beginning, and I think it's really worth just re-emphasizing, the benefit of creating a care account and you applying to be registered to have a care account, which is the mechanism for clocking up your entitlement to the cap coming in, was an opportunity to prevent. It's an opportunity to prevent and postpone need, which is being lost. And I think that, in the end, will actually cost us all more as a consequence. But it was also an opportunity for the local authority to prevent people falling back on public resources by actually having an early conversation and signposting into the necessary financial advice that people could financially plan. And we know from some of the products and research that have been in the market for some time that where those are available, they can avoid people falling back onto state resources. It can actually save the Exchequer some money as well. So the awareness piece is absolutely critical, and I really welcome what Thomas was saying earlier about the public interest duty of the organisation to actually go out there, not to be political, but to be very clear at helping in the general public discourse about these issues. And it will go back up the agenda during this Parliament. I'm absolutely clear about that. And I think this sort of professional voice setting out dispassionately the evidence is really very important to moving this agenda forward.
Thank you. Any more contributions from the floor? Yes, we have another one in the third row here.
David Martins, my name. I think the topic is really fascinating, and I think a combination of more interesting products and communication education is obviously required. I think the whole of life after retirement needs to be considered in the new products. There's a kind of U-shape that people follow at the early stages of retirement. The need for finance is quite high because people are still healthy enough to be able to enjoy life and go on nice holidays and so on. It dips down typically throughout retirement, and some people drop off the scale at that stage. Others, however, go up in their expenditure substantially at the end of life. I have a personal experience of this with two parents, one of which dropped off before that extra cost was required, and the other one much later. And it really is quite a puzzle to know what to do, and some, you know, useful thinking as to what sort of products might be available. I think there was mention in the presentation about the low cost of the deferred type annuity that might be required in the case of Avail Health, and I think that would be useful. But I think we should look at it in the context of the whole of retirement and not just the very end.
Thank you. Tom, do you want to comment on that?
Sure. Yeah. I think the point around retirement income, retirement needs, and the profile, the U shape, and I think there are possibly different shapes depending on your own kind of attitude to lifestyle and that sort of thing. I think it goes back to the point around potentially different products for different people. So for someone that is kind of wants to live for today, then maybe they'll want to have a drawdown product, and they're willing to take on the investment risk and longevity risk associated with that, assuming that they're informed of those risks. Perhaps that's a product for them. If someone wants to get rid of all financial uncertainty, then perhaps they'll go for a disability-linked annuity if that's made available on the market. If someone's pre-retirement, then perhaps they'll go for a protection product, a pre-funded protection product. I think it really depends on the person, their attitude to risk, and their understanding of the different risks. And I think I was coming back to that complexity point that was raised earlier. I think there's perhaps one of the obvious answers to solving that complexity point is for the government to provide a solution. But then that would be going back to Jules' question around compulsion. And that's not really something that we've been looking at. But I think I can't really see you getting away from a complex system unless you take the responsibility away from the individual. I just can't see how you can do that.
Do you think, I mean, linked into the broader discussion on freedom and choice in pensions, do you think we'll see a significant growth in the deferred annuity market in the UK?
Yeah, I believe so. I think it's potentially quite an attractive product, where once people are made aware of longevity risk, and I think we're doing a lot in that area to raise the profile of it. Providers will come out with products that perhaps bolt on to drawdown products. You know, so I do think it's something that will come into the market at some point.
Anything more from the audience? It looks like we're winding to a close. Maybe I could work my way along the panel, finishing with you, Tom. Yeah. Paul, any comments you'd like to make in kind of winding up?
Just one final thing I think I would just observe. I think the debate about how we pay as individual citizens for our long-term care costs and the wider question of the sustainability of our social care system actually has to be framed, I think, in a wider debate about both our health and care system. and some of the arbitrary decisions that were made in the 1940s about how the line was drawn between health and social care, and how that line has moved in an ad hoc way, in a piecemeal way, in a not a way that's actually been subject to much public debate over the last 60, 70, 80 years. My colleague Norman Lamb, who succeeded me as care minister in the coalition government, with support across parties, has been advancing the notion that we need to have, whether you call it another beverage or whether you call it an independent commission with government support, that actually ask some of those really awkward questions about why is it someone with dementia finds themselves in the social care system picking up most of the costs of that unplanned for condition, while someone perhaps with a cancer that is the result of smoking has all of their costs picked up by the state. Those issues of fundamental equity do need to be, I think, reopened in order to actually design and create a fair and probably sustainable tax-funded system, as well as identifying those things where the individual should bear the risk and fund their costs themselves.
Richard.
So I think one of the points that came up again in the questions was around how products can add complexity. And I do agree with that to an extent, but I think part of that is down to the need being complex. I mean, different products doing different things, and actually the need for care is a complex one. But also part of that is also the state support is very complex as well. So to an extent that can be simplified, then that will help then the products that we develop become simpler, I think, as a result. But those things probably aren't going to change anytime soon. So I think then really the opportunity is, as we were kind of saying, how we can kind of then help customers understand the options, and maybe the development of more holistic tools to look at all the different options and what works for them for different risk appetites and profiles of people, really. So I think that's where I think that there's a big opportunity is the front end and sort of not at product level, but more kind of the holistic kind of solution, really. Yeah.
Thank you. Okay, Tom, if you could close for us, that'd be great.
Sure. Thanks, Otto. I think I'll quickly pick up where Jerry left off with just highlighting the recommendations that we made in our paper, and then I'll pick up on some of the elements that have been covered in the debates. So one of the recommendations that we made in our paper was that there should be a joint government and industry approach to collecting data on how people are responding to the new system, and that will help to assess whether education, the use of default retirement options, or incentives for long-term care products such as tax relief and employer contributions could be effective in helping people to use their savings to meet care costs. Another recommendation, which I think we've already touched on, was around the national awareness raising campaign, and that will help people to understand what their potential care costs might be, what state support is available, and possible products that might protect them from having to make a decision at the point of crisis, which is often the things that we hear about when we have these debates around care. A lot of people don't really realise or understand the system. And the third recommendation was around how to incentivise people to save. So assuming that we've got this model where individuals need to save for their care costs, what could be done to incentivise or increase the incentive to save? One of our recommendations is that there could be a new product or category of products that allow savings to be exempt from the means test up to a specified threshold. That would increase the awareness of care funding, because product providers would obviously promote those products. The government would make people aware of the product. The cost of introducing this new exemption could be met by removing existing loopholes, which aren't widely made public, but are a lot of advisors are aware of them, which one of them is investment bonds currently are exempt from the means test, which means that, and some life assurance products, which means that if people are minded to do so, they can place significant amounts of assets in those vehicles and they can still qualify for the means test. And those are the three recommendations, the main recommendations from our paper. Picking up on some of the points from the debate, I think, as Jerry highlighted from our analysis in our paper, regional variation is a big factor in care funding. there's variation in actual the cost of care. There's variation in the way that the new Care Act is actually applied to individuals in the different regions. And there's also regional variation in the supply and the split between self-funders and local authority-funded individuals. So regional variation is a very important point, and I don't think there's an easy answer to that one. But perhaps that's something that we could, as a profession, we could help to provide an answer to, given that there's been a deferral of the implementation. Compulsion, I think that's a very good question, and I do think that should be revisited as part of the research that the profession is doing at the moment on the sustainability of funding models. Complexity, yep, we've made the point in our paper around the system's very complex. We need a way of informing individuals about how it works so that they are given the opportunity to save for their potential care costs. But also, we need a way of doing that that doesn't completely confuse people and put them off dealing with it at all. And I guess that's a difficult one to solve in itself. And supply of care, I think someone raised that point. Is there a sufficient supply of good quality care homes in the UK? And I guess from what you read in the media, see in the media, the answer probably is that there isn't. But again, going back to the demographics, you've got to think if you're a supplier of care homes, you would think it is a great opportunity to actually build new care homes, as long as the funding works. And I suppose that goes back to where I can imagine in the southeast, where there's a lot of self-funders, it's a very attractive place to build a care home. In the north, where it's mostly local authority-funded individuals, perhaps it's not so attractive, and maybe more needs to be done about that. Otherwise, there's going to be a geographic variation in the quality of care, which is obviously not ideal. Those are the main points.
Thanks, Tom. Well, it's down to me now just to wind the evening up. A couple of observations, I think. I was struck by something Paul said, actually, which was that as this Parliament goes on, as we begin to approach the next election, it's clear this subject will begin to move up the agenda again in terms of the focus. And I think, for me, that's always been where, for the profession, there was a significant opportunity to give an objective point of view on a subject which is very difficult for the policymakers to find a sensible destination in, and where actually I think our contribution could be extremely useful. So I'd encourage the group to keep working. I'd encourage anybody in the audience who's interested to consider becoming involved in some way. But I'd like to thank the contribution we've had tonight from all the speakers and the panellists, and particularly those who've been involved in the group for the excellent work that you've done, and encourage you to carry on with it and look forward to its development over the months to come. That's it. If anybody brought any prepared notes with you, if you could hand those to the team on the way out, that'd be really helpful for the British Actuarial Journal as they prepare their resume of the evening. But other than that, I'll wish you well and hope you have a great evening. Thank you very much for attending.